the City of Stones, Episode 1, Taken at the Ebb. The year is 1939. Place, Istanbul. Once the proud capital of two empires, and for nearly 2,000 years, the most cosmopolitan city in the world. The empires are gone now, crumbled into the dust that settles on the pages of the old books that go unread in an age of new and unyielding ideas. But the capital of Constantine and Suleiman is still home to the errant sons and daughters of half a hundred nations, whose wanderings have brought them here, to the city that was once called the navel of the world. Many are here for only a short time, others will never again leave. Among the most recent arrivals is Jack Moody, who has escaped Prague just ahead of the Nazi Wehrmacht, washing up a little under 3 hours ago on the shores of the Golden Horn, deposited by the tides of fortune at the Hotel Zion, a modest caravanserai near Sakeji Station in the Eminönü district. Until recently a journalist, Moody has been fired from his newspaper over spiteful allegations of irregularities in his expenses, and is living off his savings for as long as they last.
I suppose before we get started, you'll want to know the facts about me.
Well, I'm 32 years old, born in Bridgeport, Connecticut, the year Marconi first sent med-made messages across an ocean. I guess it got in my blood somehow, because I've never been happy unless I'm abroad, telling the folks back home things they'll never find out for themselves. I got my first break covering foreign affairs for the Hartford Current, and then I got picked up by the Boston Globe for the Berlin Beat, because I speak German. When I got my letter of dismissal, I just started drifting, I guess. Ended up here. I couldn't say why. All I know is, I can't go back to the States. What am I gonna be? One more jobless Joe among millions? I figure I've got a better chance over here, with the rest of the lost souls. Hey, sweetheart, who's the old fellow with the pince-nez?
That's Mr. Popescu, from Romania. He used to be a writer and a journalist, but he crossed the Legion and they beat him and threatened his life. So he came here. We try to be nice to him. He's had a raw deal from life. Oh, and don't call me sweetheart.
The Legion was the Romanian fascist movement.
Sure thing, dollface. Say, is that an American accent? How'd you end up so far from home?
My grandpa owns the hotel. He bought it from my uncle after the Nazis took away his factory. The school I was teaching at fired me so they could hire a Christian girl with half the qualifications, so I came out here to lend a hand. It beats looking for a job in America in this depression.
Don't I know it. That's too bad about your grandpa.
I wish I could have said more, but I never was eloquent, not about serious things. I guess strong emotions make me uncomfortable, like I was walking through a minefield. But I was in Germany most of the 30s. I saw what Hitler and his band of reprobates and mental patients were capable of, even if they made nice to us Nordic New Englanders.
Too bad about you, too. I guess we're two of a kind, moved aside to make way for the folks with the right parents. Say now, what's the owner's daughter doing tending bar?
The hotel isn't making money like it used to when Uncle Herschel was alive. We can't afford to hire anyone for the job. It's already more than we can pay to give the maids what they deserve.
Well, put me down for a few dollars donation towards a new barkeep, on the rocks. Not that there's anything too shabby about the old one.
Here you go, Mr. Moody. Your 80-proof mitzvah.
And something for Popescu. What's he drinking?
Plum brandy. We have to order it from Bucharest. He goes through enough of it.
I saw a flash of something in her eyes that I couldn't remember seeing for a long time. I think they call it humanity. I made a guess.
You aren't charging him full price anyway.
We're giving it to him at cost. Under cost sometimes. You, on the other hand, are paying full price.
Naturally. Plus a tip. Call it my good deed for the decade.
She looked impressed, if I'm any judge, even if it was despite herself. I didn't know what had gotten into me spending like that. Sure as hell I couldn't afford it. I don't know if I wanted to impress her or prove I wasn't like the bastards who showed her the door. Could be I was trying to reward her for caring, as she seemed genuinely to do. Maybe I just wanted to do a good deed, what she'd called a mitzvah, although I had an inkling the word didn't mean precisely that. What it did mean, I don't know. What, I look like a rabbi to you? Guess I ought to shave. So naturally, she took the snifter along to Popescu, and he asked her something I was too far away to catch, but I could guess anyway. It wasn't hard. She replied, and he said something else. She came back over to the bar.
Mr. Popescu says thank you for the drink, and would you join him? He says he'd come to you, but his leg is acting up with the damp. The one the Iron Guard broke when they...
Say no more. I'll go and present myself at court without delay. Looking at him close up, I guessed that Popescu was a tall man once. But the fascist goons who'd worked him over had broken him, in body and I thought in spirit, as much the powerlessness as the physical pain itself. I'd seen his type before. Sometimes I feared I'd end up one myself. The martyrs. The would-be Zolas who hurled their shrill j'accuses in vain against the juggernaut of ideology 100 times more potent, and hates 1,000 times more virulent than the ones that condemned Dreyfus. And they broke, inevitably, because reason was an anachronism when all that counted were bullets and tanks and colored shirts and faceless ideologies that mustn't ever be questioned. In person, he was nothing much to look at. His beard, which came to a point in the old pre-war style, might once have looked dignified or intellectual. Now, with him slumped in his chair, nursing his knees and his drink, it just looked like a bad joke.
What is your name, young man?
Jack Moody.
Would I be far wrong if I guessed you were a journalist? Pardon me, but you have, I think, the look of one.
The emphasis goes squarely on the were, I'm afraid.
I'm sorry to hear that.
No need to be. At least I got out of the business with my head intact.
Oh, they left my head undamaged. May I take it that it is to my own, how shall I say, misfortunes that you refer? They wanted me to remember the lesson they gave. I assume that it was the charming Mademoiselle Fine who told you my story.
She did, unless there's another charmed mademoiselle around that I didn't notice. I'm sorry to bring it up. I guess it's pretty hard to talk about.
Not one half so hard as this to think about, and twice as hard as it would be to write about. I was a journalist too, you know.
So I was a journalist and you were a journalist. What does that make us now?
I hope you'll forgive me for saying it, but I rather think it makes us the cohort of the damned.
I won't argue with that. For the Eighth Circle of Hell, though, this ain't a bad location. I figured I was in for a pretty fair slice of the fire and the brimstone.
The Eighth Circle?
Flatterers and deceivers.
Flatterers and... Oh, I see. Dante. I suppose we must be in our profession sooner or later. I confess you're too quick for me, Mr. Moody. I think that... Excuse me, I must go now.
What's wrong?
Nothing at all. I've forgotten an appointment. Thank you for the drink. I'm sorry, but I must go now. I hope that we will talk more together another time.
Sure, but...
Please excuse me.
Appointment my foot. He was terrified. I could tell. The only thing that happened, though, was that this weird little joker appeared at the window. A runty-looking character in a bright pink bow tie with a silver-topped umbrella and spats. I recognized the type. A flashy little crook with pretensions of being somebody. That kind are all cowards, but dangerous, the way any rat's dangerous. And the resemblance doesn't end there. What Popescu was doing mixed up with him, I didn't know. But from his reaction, I didn't think they were regular bridge partners. Since I didn't have anything better to do, I resolved to find out. Maybe do the old boy a good turn. I was left pretty much alone in the place, except for a fat Greek by the window, quietly serenading his cheap ouzo, and a cool-looking character over in the corner smoking an expensive cigarette from a holder, who I hadn't seen come in. And an interesting study he made, too. Looked like a native Turk as far as I could judge, but he dressed like an Englishman, or maybe a Frenchie, and not a poor one either. Not the kind of person you'd expect to see at a dive like the Hotel Zion. And he lurked like a professional, didn't do any of the little things that get you noticed out of the corner of an eye. If he hadn't stood up, I'd have never known he was there. He finished his gin and put on his hat to go. He must have noticed me looking at him, though I could have sworn he never turned in my direction. He'd been facing away from me and Popescu towards the bar. I say he must have seen me because when he got up, he looked right at me and twinkled his eyes and gave me a quiet little smile that said, "You're seeing me because I want you to, and for no other reason, but no hard feelings, right?" When he'd left, I'd wandered over to his table. I suspected he'd been watching us the whole time, and it occurred to me that he might have looked in the mirror over the bar. I was sure I would have noticed that, though. I admit I was sneaking a glance or two in Miss Fine's direction while I was talking to Popescu, and anyway, you couldn't see our table in it from where he was sitting. But, that clever bastard, you couldn't see us in the mirror, but you could see the window, and there was our table, neatly reflected in the glass. Hey, Dollface, do you know the guy who was sitting over here?
Never seen him before. And don't call me Dollface.
Sure thing.
Or honey, or toots, or kid, or darling. Farsteist.
Whatever you say, Mydala.
This has been part 1 of Taken at the Ebb. The City of Stones will return after a word from our sponsor.
Artichoke!
Next week, another word.